I like to think of John Alton as the Greta Garbo of cameramen, because in his own field, in a way, he was equally celebrated, equally mysterious, because at the top of his career, he just walked away and never came back. And that's created an aura and a legend about him that's unlike any other cinematographer.
He gave you quality and suggestions like no other cameraman that I ever worked with, and I've worked with the best of them. Well, he's a brilliant man. I lost contact with him when he went to South America.
The thing about Alton is that he's always, among film buffs and film historians, been considered the ultimate definitive film noir cinematographer. Never had there been in Hollywood before such darkly lit pictures as what Alton started doing in the late 40s.
What did you pick me up for? I'm talking to you. Answer me. Why'd you pick me up? There he is, Mr. Brown. I was softening him up for you. I did a pretty good job.
I told you not to touch him.
I didn't hurt him. We're still legal.
The trouble with you, McClure, is that you never took time to learn technique.
They used to light pictures just so that the audience could see the pictures. And the producers, who knew nothing more than that, they insisted upon light. So the cameramen that were working, they put a lot of lights on the right side, the left side, and they just pumped a lot of light in, and that was the lighting in those days. But then the time came when the mood was introduced into pictures, and they had to cut down on pictures, lights here, lights there, and start mood lighting. In other words, a dramatic picture requires different lighting than a comedy.
Alton just went further than anyone else did. No one else had had the guts or the nerve to light a set with just one light before. And you'll see these fantastic scenes at night where maybe down a long tunnel, you'll just have one light at the end of it and you won't see anything else. Alton was not afraid of the dark.
The first location we went to, I didn't see any big lights. I just saw a couple of inkies and things like that. And it was in this underground kind of thing. I said, John, what's going on? He says, well, I don't use much light. I stop and do this and that with black and white. And sure enough, on the screen, it was gorgeous. He had the guts to use very little light, you know. But he had an effect of those days. That black and white was so beautiful that it was almost like it was painted.
I spent a lot of time in Paris, not working, but studying at the different museums. I used to go to museums and spend their days and started lighting, and I knew that someday, at that time it wasn't important because Hollywood didn't light. But I started lighting, I watched the big masters. They were lighting masters before Hollywood even existed, starting with Rembrandt, you know. He was one of the greatest lighting men, you know. And I came back to Hollywood and tried to apply it to films.
When he made his first film at Metro, they were afraid that he wasn't giving adequate exposure, and they secretly sent men around with light meters to check up on him. But actually, John, as well as his artistic feeling, had quite a scientific approach to films. On a film I did with him for RKO, I had just one day in a very tight schedule to shoot on the street over what was supposed to be a small town. And I said, John, I'll never be able to finish this stuff in one day. He said, don't worry. If it gets dark, you can go on shooting. It'll match. I'd never heard a cameraman say that before. But as dusk fell, he set up his lights. We called a coffee break of about 10 minutes. And when it was really dark, we went on shooting, and his stuff matched absolutely perfectly the scenes within the same sequence which had been taken in blazing daylight and blazing sun.
There's one very interesting film called The Spiritualist, where I think Alton put special effort into three or four sequences. It's got a very, very otherworldly feel to it.
It creates an atmosphere, you see, a mood like music.
Even under very restricted conditions, Alton, you know, could do very, very inspired work.
He could visualize immediately where lots of cameramen have to experiment, or put the light here and then move it a little bit and so forth.
He was close to you last night. And he's close to you now. But wait. Maybe I should repel him.
He used fewer lights because he recognized that shadows were just as important as the light.
It might be dangerous.
How could Paul's presence possibly be dangerous to me?
To your plans. You want to get married and lead what is termed a normal life?
We had an airport to shoot. And he made a suggestion to me. Drape the stage in black velvet. And we'll put a revolving light that goes around like so. And he said, you will have an airport and I'll have it for you in about 10 minutes.
He took, I would think, less than half the time of any of the many other cameramen I worked with. But more important than that is he had such an artistic feeling.
He was the first person to write a book about cinematography. It was a very, very detailed, a very renowned book. It came out in about 1948.
There weren't that many books written at the time that had anything to do with motion picture lighting. So this is the book that you came across. And it was an extremely articulate work by someone who had a style and a vision and very definite opinions on how things should be done. It did teach you the flexibility of placing one light in the right place and that you didn't need a lot of lights. Nonetheless, even though that was one of his tenets, you have diagrams in the book on very complicated setups which had every light in the entire universe. You would not think this is the same man talking who is also on record as being one of the fastest cinematographers to ever work in Hollywood.
MGM didn't like it because it gives away all the secret of lighting, you know. And the other cameraman didn't like it either, the photographers, but it spread. Because there was no university that could teach lighting at that time, you know, because it was unknown as a profession.
Lights of Frisco. Barking out in a minute. You know, I've been doing a lot of thinking lately. A laugh. 5 or 10 minutes, we'll be pulling out. Pulling out for a new country. Leaving everything behind. Maybe we can make a different life for ourselves in South America.
It was one of the ironies of Alton's career that he really started making his mark working for these tiny studios like Republic and Eagle Lion and so on in the mid to late 40s. And then suddenly he was hired by MGM. And you would think MGM, which is really well known for its brightly lit sets where you see everything, the upper class settings of most of the films, and suddenly Alton comes along and imposes in certain films a very, very dark look on MGM films. Probably the darkest of all of Alton and Mann's films is Border Incident. And I can well imagine the executives at MGM freaking out when they saw this.
Why did you beat me up?
Why were you trailing me?
Why were you following the braceros?
What do I know about any braceros?
What are you up to?
Maybe you are of the police, huh? Yeah, sure. I'm right from Scotland Yard.
His color work, clearly his most famous work in color was with Vincent Minnelli, and for the film he won an Oscar for, American in Paris, it's important to know that he only shot the ballet. that another cameraman shot the bulk of the picture, but when they came around to the ballet, Minnelli hooked up with Alton and came up with an incredible design. See what he brought to it, because the constant changes of dramatic lighting in that ballet sequence are extraordinary.
The ballet saved the picture, made the picture. Without the ballet, they couldn't sell it, even the Gene Kelly. Gene Kelly, I didn't like very much because the public of Hollywood asked to be shown the picture, and they decided to show them the picture one night. And at the end, they wanted to know who did the lighting for the picture. And there was a silence for a while, and Gene Kelly stepped forward, and he says, "Well, of course, don't ask me." He says, "I did the lighting." There was a silence. The audience knew that he couldn't do the lighting, because I said, I started talking. I said, "He couldn't light a cigarette," you know, I told him. And I left.
And then he went on to shoot a few more films for Minnelli in color. And then with Richard Brooks was a very important collaboration. And again, if you sort of have a background in Alton's work in the film noir, and you see even certain scenes in Elmer Gantry, there are fantastic scenes where he's working just with pools of light, and the characters can kind of walk in and out of those lights, and it's clear that Alton brought a lot to them.
Praying or planning to take over?
Shara. How was it? Did I do all right?
After he shot Elmer Gantry, he shot one or two more tiny little films and then was gone. And we never heard about him again for over 30 years after that.
I stopped because I wanted to live, you know. There was no life to work in the studio, get up at 6 every morning and fight the producers and come home tired and so on. I had enough. I looked at my bank book and I said, "That's it." And I stopped. Later on, I felt I would have liked to make some big pictures again, but then I had a lot of fun.